that. First up, though, let's talk about, well, coming back to the terror issue, well, the process of Islamic radicalization and how we tackle it. We've been speaking to many guests today about the need to, for the prevent strategy, needs to tackle the issue of radicalization going on in our own country. Let's talk now to Dr. Alan Mendoza. He's founder and executive director of the Henry Jackson Society. They are a think tank looking at these issues over many years, combating extremism and advancing the values of democracy. Alan, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, Julia.
In terms of what we have learned from this terror attack, in terms of have we learned anything new, or is this, for want of a horrific better phrase, same old, the same old story of someone who's been radicalised and perhaps for someone who could have been predicted as someone who would cause such terror on our streets?
Well, in a sense, it is the latter, unfortunately. I mean, of course, we've yet to discover the precise nature of the radicalization that the bomber went through, when it happened, and who, in fact, radicalized him. But clearly, there was a process where somebody who was not radical at one point became radical over time, and that radicalization tipped over into violent radicalization. And I think, of course, there were, during that period, he was reported to the authorities. We've yet to understand exactly the nature of, you know, how he was reported, how the report, you know, the authorities responded to that. But of course, the end result of that was, sadly, that he was able to carry out his nefarious plot.
Well, indeed. And again, in terms of that process of radicalization, it does seem, of course, you know, his family, obviously, they'd come from Libya as refugees. The family decided to return to Libya. We've heard arrests, not just in Britain, of his older brother, but his younger brother and his father in Libya. The links with Al-Qaeda, links with the Islamic State over here. Do we have any idea of, like, what it was that was the tipping point, not just for him to be radicalized, but the tipping point for him to be radicalized to the extent that he would actually cause, you know, the death of innocent children? Because those are very big tipping points, aren't they?
Well, there are. I mean, obviously, there's a whole history of the connection of sort of Libyan exiles, the Manchester area, jihadism. You know, it's a long story coming from the 1990s when Britain opened its doors to Islamists who were opposed to the Gaddafi regime and were basically driven out by Gaddafi. At the time, of course, we had a policy of basically welcoming anyone. Didn't matter what your cause was, we would have you in here, thinking rather foolishly that it wouldn't come back and bite us. Of course, we learnt to our cost that wasn't the case. But the issue is that over time, you've seen links between Libya, between Syria, the development of, you know, sort of ISIS ideology. You've seen a number of Manchester-based jihadists who have been jailed or killed or have been named as fighting for ISIS. And, you know, with him having gone to Libya recently, with the connections, as you say, it would have been easy for him to have met people over there who could have brought him into this sort of world. And again, we don't know the precise details just yet, but you can see how this happens. You can see how it works and how somebody could be turned into this violent area. And I just want to point what you said about, you know, he picked children and this was the target. And whether it was him or whether it was somebody else, of course, we still don't know who actually chose the target. But it's a very deliberate target. A lot's been written about this. But what they were targeting was our own, if you like, our own culture, our own ability for young women empowerment. Ariana Grande is very much about that. Her female fans are very much about the same thing. It was a message. It was saying Western women know your place.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. When we go back to the attacks in Paris, the Bataclan, a lot of that was about, you know, the mixing of different cultures, people drinking, laughing, enjoying themselves, music and the like, that this is what they disapprove of. A lot of people are very confused, and I'm among them, about that somebody could become radicalised who's, he's second generation immigrant, but his parents have been given safe haven in this country. And when people talk about how it's the attacks on Muslim countries, Iraq, Afghanistan, elsewhere, that propagate this, they become the recruiting sergeant for radical Islam and for young men and women here. But the bombing that we did carry out in Libya was to save the lives of innocent Libyans who would have been bombed in Benghazi by Colonel Gaddafi's forces, from whom his parents had fled from that evil, murderous regime. I think for a lot of people, it's very confusing that someone would turn against people in this country when his family had been offered that refuge.
Well, it's only confusing if you believe this really is about foreign policy and such like. If you actually look at what's going on, the people behind the attacks, the ideologues there, the ideology comes first. It's an ideology based on the text of Islam. It's an interpretation of that text, which is different to what most Muslims believe, but it's still an interpretation that they can link back to Muslim texts and Muslim hadith sayings of the Prophet in that kind of way. And they, the ideology they have is one of hatred of the lifestyle we lead in the West. They have a different idea for how life should be ordered, what should be happening in life. And the foreign policy bit comes after, not before. It's not that, you know, foreign policy happens and then people discover the ideology. No, the ideology comes first. These people believe in these things and they can fasten on anything that will aid their cause. So the fact that we have, as you suggest, you know, gone into Libya back in at the time of the toppling of Gaddafi to save people's lives is irrelevant to this cause. It becomes then not about Libya, it becomes about Syria or Iraq or how this all connects up. They will use whatever argument. In the 1990s, it was about Bosnia. They will use whatever argument is current at the time in order to advance your ideology. And you can see how the potent mix of ideology and, you know, whatever grievances they wish to raise can lead to young people in particular being fired up to do what the ideologues want. I think perhaps the most disturbing aspect of this is, of course, the network aspect of this plot. Clearly, the bomber was acting as a mule. He didn't prepare the bomb himself. Somebody else prepared that bomb. It's somebody else who had the ideology to do it and used him for their purposes. And that's where we're at the moment, this kind of problem of not understanding that it's ideology that drives this. It is about a version of Islam. It's not nothing to do with religion. And it is being propagated by people who hate us and our way of life.
Indeed. And the simple fact that we exist and carry on our daily lives is what they hate. And if we don't understand that and what they want to destroy, then we can't tackle the problem. Dr. Alan Mendoza, thank you so much for talking to us. He's founder and executive director of the Henry Jackson Society, a think tank tackling radicalization. Very much appreciate you joining us. Coming